Here we are, Andy. You're jumping at my nose.
Sacks are hoisted up the mill when needed and either emptied into the bins or put through the grain cleaner to clean it before it goes into the bin. The grain cleaner has three little sieves, which removes any large objects and shriveled grain. Once the grain is at the top of the mill, gravity feeds it down through the various processes. On the floor below, clean grain shoots into the large bin on the bin floor. Below the bin floor is the stone floor. Here, David checks the flow of grain into the hopper before he starts up the mill. Another floor down, David the miller puts a clean sack over the spout to catch the flour. The sails are set, the stones are put into gear, the wind is blowing, so it's time for David to release the brake and start the mill. The grain comes out at the bottom of the hopper and into the shoe, which is being shaken so the flow of the grain is proportional to the speed of the mill. The angle of the shoe can be adjusted from the mill floor to ensure that the rate of milling is consistent with the amount of power that the wind is providing.
Grain from the millstone comes in the middle here and travels down the grooves or furrows, and as it does so, the pattern of the grooves on the top millstone scissors the grain open and spreads the flour onto the flat parts here, which then grinds it into fine flour. That then passes over onto the other furrow, which pushes it out of the millstone.
The flour, which is wholemeal at this stage, falls out of the stones and down a spout into a sack on the mill floor below.
There we go. Beautiful. Here we go.
Hello, I'm George Green. Welcome to my windmill. My father built it in 1807, and I've been the miller here for most of my life. I enjoy my work, but my real passion is mathematics. When the wind is still, I like to spend time up on the top floor, where it's quiet working on my theorem. Mind you, it's not always quiet. This is a working windmill, so you'd best take care. In a windmill, things which look like they shouldn't move have a habit of moving inside. And there are a lot of steep stairs. I don't want to see any of you hurt, so take care on them. Anyhow, if you'd like to see around, I suggest you start on the top floor and work your way down. That's the best way to see how the wheat becomes the flour. Enjoy your visit.
Thank you. think so.
Sacks are hoisted up the mill when needed and either emptied into the bins or put through the grain cleaner to clean it before it goes into the bins. Which remove any large objects and shriveled grain. Once the grain is at the top of the mill, gravity feeds it down through the various processes. On the floor below, clean grain shoots into the large bins on the bin floor. Checks the flow of grain into the hopper before he starts up the mill. Another floor down, David the miller puts a clean sack over the spout to catch the flour. The sails are set, the stones are put into gear, the wind is blowing, so it's time for David to release the brake and start the mill.
Yeah, this is a classic. grain comes out of the bottom of the hopper and into the shoe, which is being shaken so the flow of the grain is proportional to the speed of the mill. The angle of the shoe can be adjusted from the mill floor to ensure that the rate of milling is consistent with the amount of power that the wind is providing.
Grain from the millstone comes in the middle here and travels down the grooves or hollows, and as it does so, the pattern of the grooves on the top millstone scissors the grain open and spreads the flour onto the flat box here, which then grinds it into fine flour. That then passes over onto the other furrow, which pushes it out of the millstone.
The flour, which is wholemeal at this stage, falls out of the stones and down a spout into the sack on the mill floor below. The sacks are hoisted up the mill when needed and either emptied into the bins or put through the grain cleaner to clean it.
Threatened tonight with more mischief being done to me, such as entering my house. Therefore, gentlemen, I most humbly crave your protection, such as the bearer of this can explain to you. From your humble servant, George Green. To the right worshipful, the mayor and his brethren. Having all my windows broke last night, and being much threatened tonight with more mischief being done to me, such as entering my house, therefore, gentlemen, I most humbly crave your protection, such as the bearer of this can explain to you. From your humble servant, George Green.
Hello, Andy. Or whether they're supposed to be getting involved in having 500 miles, and when I have a problem like that, I need the right tools to tackle it with. Now, the best tools to get the tyre off the rim are tyre levers. You can use spoons, you can use screwdrivers if you're desperate, but tyre levers are the best. My next hero invented a tool to solve problems in physics, and it was a mathematical tool, which is odd because he wasn't a physicist, he wasn't even a mathematician. He was a miller, and this was his windmill. His name was George Green.
Green spent only a year at school when he was 8, and then in 1807, just outside Nottingham in the village of Snenton, his dad built this windmill and set his son to work in it. So it's all the more surprising that George Green invented a crucial mathematical tool that is used by physicists and mathematicians even today.
Every day when the wind was blowing, he would come here in the mill to grind corn. Now, they actually employed a manager to run the mill, and the manager's house was built right onto the side of the windmill here. In fact, this white stuff here is the remains of the plaster from the manager's front room. George got very friendly with the manager's daughter, Jane Smith. Indeed, they had 7 children together, and yet, for some reason, they never got married. When his dad died, young George inherited the mill. But increasingly, he found the work of milling irksome, as he put it. So he left the day-to-day business to his manager, and he concentrated on what he enjoyed doing, which, curiously, wasn't stamp collecting or something like that, but mathematics. Amazingly complicated, continental-style mathematics.
The 100-year-old work of Isaac Newton still ruled British maths in Green's time, and the academics stubbornly refused to use any of the ideas based on the work of Newton's arch-rival from Germany, Gottfried Wilhelm Leibniz. Unfortunately, Leibniz's continental maths turned out to be better than Newton's, but virtually nobody in Britain knew anything about it.
In 1828, George Green published an essay, a mathematical essay, all about static electricity, using the most fantastically complicated continental mathematics. George had to pay out of his own pocket to get his essay printed. So what he did was put an ad in the local paper inviting people to subscribe. And they did, 51 of them, coughed up 7 and 6 pence, which was very expensive for an essay. He printed 100 copies, and when those 51 got their copies, they must have been a bit shocked. If you look at this, the title is An Essay on the Application of Mathematical Analysis to the Theories of Electricity and Magnetism. Snappy title, isn't it? Well, just look at the text. It's absolutely unbelievable. I can't believe many of those people can possibly have read this. But one person who did was a chap called Sir Edward Bromhead, who'd actually studied maths at Cambridge, and he understood it, and he realised that this was very important. He wrote to George at once, and said George ought to get this essay published in London, so everyone could see it. But George thought he was just being polite, and he didn't feel sort of able to write back to a knight of the realm, and it took him 18 months to reply to Bromhead's letter. Well, eventually, Bromhead persuaded Green to go to Cambridge, and in due course, he became a fellow of Gonville and Caius College. Unfortunately, Cambridge society didn't really agree with him. He was only a humble miller. And he eventually succumbed to miller's disease from breathing all the dust in the mill here. And in 1841, he died. And his essay lay lost and forgotten until 4 years later. In 1845, William Thompson was a student at Cambridge. He was keen on continental maths, and he had heard of Green's essay, but he couldn't find a copy, until he asked one of Green's old tutors, who just happened to have three copies lying around. Thompson read the essay on top of the stagecoach on his way to Paris with growing excitement. When he got there, he showed all his French colleagues, and they were even more excited because they realised that Green's work solved all the problems they'd been working on. His essay was rediscovered. There's a chunk in Green's essay which came to be called Green's Theorem. And because it's a mathematical tool, it's quite hard to explain what it is, but I have begun to understand what you could do with it. And here's a rather simple example. Imagine that this wooden square is a disco, and the white bit in the middle is the dance ball. Now, I'm not a great dancer, so I'm sitting here on this edge in my Picardian coat, watching all the goings on. Now, there are loads and loads of people on the dance floor. I can only see a little edge here, but I can see who's coming and going across that edge. And knowing just that much, I can work out who's coming and going all the way around, how many people are crossing the edge of the dance floor. And using Green's theorem, I can then work out the total population of the dance floor, how many people are heaving about on there. And that is an example of its use.
This is a simple example. But the brilliant thing about Green's theorem is that it can be applied to anything from how much charge is in a microchip to problems in acoustics, magnetism, and even hydrodynamics. George Green wrote his essay in the time of classical physics. Then 100 years after his death, a new generation of physicists, quantum physicists, discovered Green's work all over again.
In fact, now it seems that every year, another bunch of scientists can use George Green's mathematical tools. Here's his grave at the bottom of the hill within sight of the windmill. There he is, George Green Esquire BA, and there's Jane buried in the next door grave. In 1930, Albert Einstein came to Nottingham to give a lecture. He was so impressed with George Green's work, he was going to come here and visit the grave, but he missed his train. So I've come instead to pay tribute to George Green, the mathematical miller.
There we go, that is Green's windmill. Woohoo! That's a good start.
Hello, I'm George Green. Welcome to my windmill. My father built it in 1807. And I've been the miller here for most of my life. I enjoy my work, but my real passion is mathematics. When the wind is still, I like to spend time upon the top.
Andy, do you want a high five?
Thank you. Cheers.
Is the stone floor. Here, David checks the flow of grain into the hopper before he starts up the mill. Another floor down, David the miller puts a clean sack over the spout to catch the flour. The sails are set, the stones are put into gear, the wind is blowing, so it's time for David to release the brake and start the mill. Shaken so the flow of the grain is proportional to the speed of the mill. The angle of the shoe can be adjusted from the mill floor to ensure that the rate of milling is consistent with the amount of power that the wind is providing.
Grain from the millstone comes in the mill here and travels down the grooves, or furrows, and as it does so, the pattern of the grooves on the top millstone scissors the grain open and spreads the flour onto the flat pots here, which then grinds it into fine flour. That then passes over onto the other furrow, which pushes it out of the millstone.
The flour, which is wholemeal at this stage, falls out of the stones and down a spout into a sack on the mill floor below. The mill floor is where the milling is controlled. You can change the gap between the stones, making the flour coarser or finer using a tentering screw. Because the wind doesn't blow at the same speed all the time, the fineness of the flour alters as the speed of the stones change. So the governor varies the gap between the stones to keep the fineness constant. The wholemeal flour is weighed into bags or put into another machine for dressing it into white flour. The flour dresser is a large sieve which separates the white flour from the wholemeal flour. When a sack is full, it can be lifted up to the mill floor to be weighed up into bags and sold in the shop.
I'd like to know what type of flour.
Yeah, we've got some wholemeal flour.
Right.
And we've got some white flour.
Right.
And we've got some oatmeal.
As the wind pushes on the sails, the sails turn the cogs inside, that then turns the post, more cogs turn, and the stones then turn to grind the wheat into flour.
When the wind pushes the sails down outside, the sails turn the large cog, that pushes the small cog, and that then turns the post.
This post turns the cog two floors below it.
So this large cog turns, and as it turns the smaller cog, which goes faster, that then turns the millstones, we go between, and it ground into flour. As the stones above turn, the flour falls down the tubes into the sack that's held on by this belt. And when we've got the flour down, we then weigh it up into smaller bags, and then that will be sold in the shop. Here we are, a lovely bag of fresh greens and flour.
Good doggy size.
Greens mill has two types of sail, common sail and spring sail. Each sail is bolted to a timber beam, the stock, which is connected to the end of the wind shaft. The common sail is a wooden lattice on which a sailcloth of canvas is spread. Each sail has a twist or weather so that the wind acting upon it produces a force which turns the sail. The sailcloth is untwisted and, using lines connected to the edge of the cloth, the sail is set. If the wind increases, the miller will stop the mill and put a reef into one of the sailcloths to reduce the sail area. The air pressure on the shutters overcomes a spring, allowing the shutters to open, preventing the mill from going too fast. The common sails provide efficiency in light winds, while the spring sails give more control if the wind should increase.
We're now in the cap, that's right at the very top of the mill. And I'm standing on the cap frame, which slides around the top of the tower so that the sails always point into the wind. The sails today are through there. They're on the other end of this wind shaft, because I'm in the cap here. This wheel here is called the brake wheel because it has the brake around it, which is actually holding it stopped at the moment, so it can go. And the brake wheel drives the wallower down there, which drives the upright shaft, which takes the drive to the millstones.
Good for any size!
Jimmy's Mill Challenge!
Hi, I'm Lawrence, and today we have four children.
Read room the windmill, yeah. With Kelly. Teletubbies. Would you film the windmills with Kelly?
Aww,
and film the windmill with Kate?
Lovely.
At the windowsill, yeah? Right there.
Hello, I'm George. Well, this is a science center, isn't it? Cool, Andy.
Is it any great as Christmas?
is big. Natural chocolate is crushed between metal pads in most supermarkets. Come on, visit C. Don't you know that it's pressed together in wooden molds in the council house? Watch it, you see how to look. Get a whistle stop tour of the mill with our good friend Graham. So, a round of applause for you guys. Brilliant stuff! Okay, guys, follow Graham, have a great time.
Okay, follow me.
Do the
mill
challenge!
So, as the wings push on the sails, the sail turned the cogs inside, that then turned the post, more cogs turned, and the sails began to line the wings
open. The answer's B! Bread is made from flour, water, yeast, salt, and a bit of oil. High five! And you can eat the bread that's worth it. Completed your challenge. Yay! And you have
won a fantastic prize. You get to go and make some bread with the delicious Green Mills flour. Yeah. Made in this mill. So come on, guys, come on. The wind moves sails. The sails move the coast. The coast moves the sails. The sails fly great to the wind.
Rosie and Jim. Here is my home. Here the air is fresh and free of the stench of the city. This place has the most beautiful view of Nottinghamshire. Take a look around, enjoy the view, and when you have taken in the beautiful sights, I shall meet you at the door. Breathe in the pure, sweet air of Snenton after the foul stench of town. My father built this mill, you know. One of the first brick tower windmills in these parts. The biggest and the best. Not like those wooden fire traps on Forest Road. I suppose he must have been in the thick of it on Kipper Street. I'm told the rioters made their way down Hockley once the news of the defeat of the bill was posted in the marketplace. Don't imagine we escaped out here in the country. Oh dear, no. We could hear them roaring all the way from town. I swear there were those among the mob who would have mounted an assault upon my mill. I herded all the family into this very room at the top and let the mob have it with my musket. I trust their ringleaders have earned themselves a trip to Botany Bay, or worse. The newspaper tells us of the effect of the riots on the castle.
Oh yay! Molten lead, running like lurid streams. Precious tapestries in flame, crackling and burning timber. Ladies and gentlemen, I bring you reports from the very eyes of your mayor, struck down in the course of serving this city, sirs. Smell, ladies and gentlemen, cedar wood. Is that the delicious odour of reform? Oh yay!
I can hear William and Jane outside. What are they talking about?
You know full well why George and I have never married.
I know full well that his proud father considered me to be of a class beneath him. It's me, William Smith, what keeps these mill sails turning, keeps these mill wheels grinding. He finds honest toil irksome and has neither knowledge of nor interest in the milling trade.
Look, they've posted a notice upon the tree over there. It tells us about the trial and the hanging of some of the rioters.
Wicked and designing men have taken advantage of a time of excitement to perpetrate outrages. Were it not for the timely arrival of the 15th Hussars to quell this uprising, I have no doubt that further destruction would have occurred. It is my unpleasant duty to pass sentence of capital punishment.
Hark! The bell does toll. We three these steps ascend. We lead them to the county jail, where the life will shortly end.
Here we are in the middle of Nottingham, and this wonderful building over here is the mill of where George Green did some work. So this is Green's mill, and it's still functioning. It was operating yesterday. So if you follow up. Ah, hello. They have a good time together, having said that. Alongside that, there's Clark Maxwell, Kelvin, and so on. And In 1993, a memorial plaque was put to George Green for the symbol of a windmill, apparently, and he's up there in the pantheon of the top British physicists of all time. They had a windmill on the plaque because nobody knows what he looked like. His daughter had an interview before her death. And so, in some sense, there's a verbal history of him, but cameras weren't around there. He wasn't famous. Nobody painted his portrait. And so there's nothing left, particularly, that shows what he looked like. I imagine he's a dusty miller, but I have no idea.
That's one video.
When I have a problem like that, I need the right tools to tackle it with. Now, the best tools to get tire off the rim are tire levers. You can use spoons, you can use screwdrivers if you're desperate, but tire levers are the best. My next hero invented a tool to solve problems in physics. And it was a mathematical tool, which is odd because he wasn't a physicist, he wasn't even a mathematician. He was a miller, and this was his windmill. His name was George Green.
Green spent only a year at school when he was 8, and then in 1807, just outside Nottingham in the village of Snenton, his dad built this windmill and set his son to work in it. So it's all the more surprising that George Green invented a crucial mathematical tool that is used by physicists and mathematicians even today.
Every day when the wind was blowing, he would come here in the mill to grind corn. Now, I actually employed a manager at right onto the
side of the window here. In fact, hello. This
is
the remains of the last of my father's.
He concentrated on what he enjoyed doing, which curiously wasn't stamp collecting or something like that, but mathematics. Amazingly complicated continental-style mathematics.
The 100-year-old work of Isaac Newton still ruled British maths in Green's time. And the academics stubbornly refused to continental maths. None of us can be connected to it. But virtually no difference you can in the Bible. In 1828, George Green published an essay. A mathematical essay, all about scattering electricity, using the most fantastically complicated continental mathematics.
To the right worship from the
mayor. George had to pay out of his own pocket to get his essay printed. So what he did was put an ad in the local paper, inviting people to subscribe. And they did, 51 of them, coughed up 7 and 6 pence, which was very expensive for an essay. He printed 100 copies, and when those 51 got their copies, they must have been a bit shocked. If you look at this, the title is An Essay on the Application of Mathematical Analysis to the Theories of Electricity and Magnetism. Sappy title, isn't it? Well, just look at the text. It's absolutely unbelievable. I can't believe many of those people can possibly have read this, but one person who did was a chap called Sir Edward Bromhead, who'd actually studied maths at Cambridge, and he understood it, and he realised this was very important. He wrote to George at once, and said George ought to get this essay published in London, so everyone could see it. But George thought he was just being polite, and he didn't feel sort of able to write back to a knight of the realm, and it took him 18 months to reply to Bromhead's letter. Well, eventually, Bromhead persuaded Green to go to Cambridge, and he eventually succumbed to Miller's disease from breathing all the dust in the mill here. And in 1841, he died. And his essay lay lost and forgotten until 4 years later. In 1845, William Thompson was a student. He read the essay on top of the stagecoach on his way to Paris with growing excitement. When he got there, he showed all his French colleagues, and they were even more excited because they realised that Green's work solved all the problems they'd been working on. His essay was rediscovered. There's a chunk in Green's essay which came before Green's theory. And because it happened, it was a fundamental experiment. calculate all the way around how many people are crossing the edge of the dance floor. And using Green's theorem, I can then work out the total population of the dance floor. How many people are heaving a bicycle? And that is an example of its use.
This is a simple example. But the brilliant thing about Green's theorem is that it can be applied to anything from how much charge is in a microchip to problems in acoustics, magnetism, and even hydrodynamics. George Green wrote his essay in the time of classical physics. Then 100 years after his death, a new generation of physicists, quantum physicists, discovered Green's work all over again.
In fact, now it seems that every year, another bunch of scientists can use George Green's mathematical tools. Here's his grave, at the bottom of the hill within sight of the windmill. There he is, George Green's Barbier, and that's Jane, buried in the next door grave. In 1930, Albert Einstein came to Nottingham to give a lecture. He was so impressed with George Green's work, he was going to come here and visit the grave, but he missed his train. So, I come instead to pay tribute to George Green, the mathematical miller.
We did it! Well done!
Well done, Andy.
It's time to go play in the park now. Let's go! I'm coming, Kelly.
In the toilet, yeah?
In the bath.
Hello, I'm George Green. Welcome to my windmill. My father built it in 1807, and I've been the miller here for most of my life. I enjoy my work, but my real passion is mathematics. When the wind is still, I like to spend time up on the top floor when it's quiet, working on my theorem. Mind you, it's not always quiet. This is a working windmill, so you'd best take care. In a windmill, things which look like they shouldn't move have a habit of moving inside. And there are a lot of steep stairs. I don't want to see any of you hurt, so take care on them. Anyhow, if you'd like to see around, I suggest you start on the top floor and work your way down. That's the best way to see how the wheat becomes a flour. Enjoy your visit. To the right worshipful, the mayor and his brethren. Having all my windows broke last night, and being much threatened tonight with more mischief being done to me, such as entering my house, therefore, gentlemen, I most humbly crave your protection, such as the bearer of this can explain to you, from your humble servant, George Green.
There's good pop now. Go windmill. Come on. Beach park. Wimmo. In our pen. Go, Wimmo. Go, Steve Wimmo. Go, Wimmo. Go, go, go. Faster. Faster as you can. Get down. Go to see Stephen's church now. We're done now. We're going to see Stephen's church now. We did it now. Finish now. We've done the church. We're done with Mal. We're going to have a look at the church, yeah? well spoken. Put the trolley here. On the white tram.
Careful. Don't look. Get back. Get back. Wait.
no cakes today. Oh, come in.
Thank you. completed your smart card before boarding. This tram is for Phoenix Park. The next stop is Noel Street.
Thank you.
Please ensure you have purchased a ticket or validated your smart card before. This tram is for Phoenix Park. The next stop is Ace 13.
Thank you.
Scrooge. Let's go, Harry. I'm coming. Jam, come here.
Thank you.
footless hill.
Stop. Be careful, the train coming. The tram coming.
coming down. Come this way, let me know your head. Move away.
Horn. Press the bell again. Whole time. After this, one more time, bell. Female. And you do it. Doing one more?
No more, it's okay.
That's it. More tram, I have to press the button again. Super Andy Gosling. Yeah, we're bell winning. Female. That's a female woman again.
Thank you.
Wendy. Take your legs off the chair.
Do this, Andy Gosling.
Oh, you can press it. Like everyone will go, yeah, sure. Put it, close the doors.
Beep! Female!
There we go, right. Let's go then. Changing drivers now.
There's a man and then we can sit Andy Gosling's seat. Andy seat.
The driver on. Would you like it?
Okay.
Andy. Here we go.
Female.
It's okay, Andy. Andy, it's okay.
Sorry, this one.
Come this way.
Come this way, then.
Getting a bit too excited,
didn't
you?
That's fine.
Thank you, though.
No worries, thank you.
And you wear that. That was a good
like
question.
Do you like a hat?
Yeah.
Oh,
no. Hang
on a second. Yes, keep it.
Shoggy, Andy. Ta-da! Found it.
Yeah, all right. You can have it. Sorry.
You can keep it.
I've got another one at home. Yeah.
Forrest, is it back to normal?
It's back to normal now, yeah, mate.
That was good. Thank you.
Have a nice
night, Jamie.
Yeah.
Centre.
What the fuck?
This tram is for Towson Lane. The next stop is Old Market Square for City Centre attractions. Female. This tram is for Tosa Lane. The next stop is Old Market Square, for City Centre attractions. Well done, Andy. Female. Good train, yeah? This is Old Market Square.
Well done.
This tram is for Tosa Lane. The next stop is Lace Market for the National Ice Centre, Nottingham Arena and Broadmarsh Shopping Centre.
Female. Thank you. lift, yeah?
Let's go.